Here we are at the building, the address where the car is, allegedly. I always have such a mix of emotions and things going on in here at a time like this. Am I on a wild goose chase? Am I in the wrong country? Is it the wrong car? Does the car even exist? Is it a figment of my imagination? So I'm going to go inside now. I'm going to see if the car is here, but it's really... Let's see. The anticipation. Hello and welcome to another Tyrrell's Classic Workshop. This time round, we have got something incredibly exciting. Every so often, hopefully, life throws us the odd wonderful thing that happens. We have a eureka moment of some sort. For me, in 2016, it was finding the Italian job at Lamborghini Miura, the car from the film. A guy called Eric Broutin in Paris alerted Olivier Nemesh, my good friend and Lamborghini historian, and myself that he might have the car. I went over, I authenticated it, I checked it out in Paris, and it was the car, and the rest is history. Lamborghini eventually decided it was the car as well, and that was a wonderful moment. And in fact, I'd go as far as to say it was a career highlight, and how would I ever have thought of topping finding a Lamborghini Miura, one of the most iconic examples of one of the most iconic cars ever made, that I watched in a movie as a kid and actually got to drive and touch and authenticate and research, etc. How could I top that? Well, I think this has actually done it. The story of Lamborghini and Ferrari is widely documented. It's widely speculated. When I say documented, I mean written about without any actual certainty. Nobody's ever brought anything really factual to the party about that story. The story goes that Enzo Ferrari and Ferruccio Lamborghini were both from the Bologna Modena area in Italy, very small locale with lots of artisans and engineers around there. And they met in a restaurant, Lamborghini and a friend of his, and Enzo Ferrari and a friend of his. The four of them were having lunch in this restaurant, not together. And Ferruccio Lamborghini had some frustrations with the clutch in a Ferrari. And he was, at the time, around about 1960, 1961, 62, he was one of the wealthiest industrialists in Italy. He had four companies, actually: air conditioning, tractors, of course, was his main staple, heating, industrial ventilation systems, huge entrepreneur and tycoon. And he indulged himself with the best sports cars that the world had to offer. He had a Mercedes 300 SL, he had an E-Type Jaguar, and he marveled at the six-cylinder engine in the E-Type Jag. In fact, he was actually quoted as saying, "Who needs a V12 when Jaguar build this?" That wonderful 3.8, as it was then, XK engine, in comparison, of course, to the Ferrari V12. But the story goes that he had problems with the clutch in his Ferrari, and he complained right then and there because he'd had terrible frustrations with the Servizio Assistenza, the service department at the Ferrari factory, about his clutch. And they had this sort of contretemps, and he walked out of the restaurant in a rage and said, "I'm going to put paid to Ferrari, I'm going to start building my own sports cars." And of course, lots of people say that, but he actually did it. The story has never been fully authenticated and proven. And one of the key elements in the story that's been missing all these years was that Ferrari 250 GT, that exact car. And the Ferrari 250 GTE, the sort of sister model to this, one of them, a body only, is displayed in the Tonino Lamborghini Museum in Funno, near Bologna. This is nothing to do with the factory, this is their own museum. And they have a Ferrari 250 GT body shell in there, which sort of exemplifies what Ferruccio had. So even they, firsthand from Tonino, Ferruccio's son, Fabio, Ferruccio's nephew, and Fabio has told me the story personally when we were out at lunch one day. So this is from two mouths away from being Ferruccio Lamborghini himself. He told me the story, but none of them could ever really pin it down. Until now. This is the car that Ferruccio Lamborghini owned when he that prompted him that spawned Lamborghini. This is the car that his name is on the registration document. He bought this car in 1960 and he sold it in 1970. And this is the car that started it all. So what I'm going to do is I've been over to Italy to authenticate this car. This came through Olivier Nemesh, and in due course I'll be speaking with him about the bigger picture of how this came to be, because he spent decades trying to find this car, and it's largely due to him that we are able to see this car in the flesh. And it's actually amazing it even exists, because a lot of these Ferrari 250 GTs with this fairly conservative Pininfarina coupe bodywork were actually, had the body taken off them and the chassis were converted, and still are being so actually, into GTO alikes or 250 California Spider alikes, because they're essentially under the skin, the chassis is the same car. It's the running gear is the same, the suspension, the brakes, the steering, etc. are all the same. So it's very easy to put a different set of clothes on it and make a very different car. But anyway, we're going to look into all this, but we've got evidence to show that this was undoubtedly the car. We've got the original registration document, the libretto, and I've also got some cine film of Ferruccio driving this car at his tractor factory at his villa in Cento with his Alsatian, getting into the car and driving it from that time. So let's just look at this story a little bit further. We've got a couple of Lamborghini tractors here. We're going to take the clutch out of those and see if they match up to bring the whole thing full circle, because of course the conclusion to the story was that he took one of his tractor clutches and put it in this exact car, and it was through that that he realized that he could improve the car by fitting one of his tractor clutches, so the story goes. We don't know about that bit, but we do know that he got this to work with one of his tractor clutches in. Well, I say we do know, that's yet to be found out, but what we do know definitively at this point is that this was his car, and this was the car that he was unhappy with. An amazing story brought to life for the first time ever in this video. So I'm going to be looking more into this now, and we'll just progress this investigation, this detective work, one step at a time. Very exciting. Well, here we are. Here we are at the building, the address where the car is, allegedly. I always have such a mix of emotions and things going on in here at a time like this. Am I on a wild goose chase? Am I in the wrong country? Is it the wrong car? Does the car even exist? Is it a figment of my imagination? All these thoughts run through my mind. I get very nervous about things like this because there's such an air of anticipation. So I'm going to go inside now. I'm going to see if the car is here, and I'm going to start doing my checking and my looking at things and making sure, authenticating, just as I did with the Italian job Miura and various other cars over the years. But it's really, let's see, the anticipation. Ah! Hello.
Everything's okay?
Pleased to meet you.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
So now I'll show you the car.
Perfect.
Or better, you can see the car.
Absolutely. Great.
Uh-huh. This is the masterpiece.
Unfinished.
You can cook this then.
A little unfinished.
Yeah.
But okay.
Everything's done.
Yeah, okay. Well, here I am. I've arrived at this workshop not far from Milan in northern Italy. It's an amazing feeling to be stood next to this car and to actually physically touch the car that is such an important, a pivotal part of Italian automotive history. I'm going to be looking at the car, I'm going to be checking over various details, making a full report for the buyer, and also checking the paperwork. I'm looking for original documents in the history, not photocopies. Original documents. So we'll press on. We'll get busy. I'm going to start looking at numbers, make sure they haven't been overstamped, filed off, rehashed, and just make sure the car is what it's purporting to be.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so we have lots of parts here. And you believe these are all original parts for the car?
Yeah, I think, yeah. They was put out from the car. So these are, I'm sure that they are original.
Yeah, this is all chrome. Yeah, this is good. This is good. These are parts that are important for me. All this right work here. Things like, you say the 5% was missing. You're thinking
this
of
this.
Door handles.
And this.
Yeah. This
but
is.
I know that they are not so impossible to find.
Yes, absolutely. The paint is good, actually.
The paint is not bad.
And the leather is good as well.
The inside is very good.
Well, this is one of those strange moments in life when I don't quite know how to feel because I've got all sorts of sentiments revolving around my head. First feeling is it's great to be stood next to this car, to actually physically touch this car that has been so apocryphal over the years. There's been so many stories told about this car and its influence on Italian automotive engineering. And here I am actually touching this car. It's been proved through looking at the paperwork and delving into the history that this was Ferruccio Lamborghini's Ferrari, that this was the car that started the whole feud, which eventually led to Lamborghini setting himself up as a serious car manufacturer, which obviously it's a different company now, but it survives to this day and it's built thousands of cars. That's a staggering achievement. It's incredibly special to be here, to have made the journey and found this car. Well, one thing I have been able to fall back on over the years is what is possibly a misspent youth. Some people would say it was playing pool or snooker. For me, it was buying car books. It's these that I can fall back on in situations such as this. And I have ascertained, I've sort of read from my library, that the clutch that was used on that car, the non-competition road-going 250 GTs, was a 9-inch diameter clutch. So we're going to just see how that marries up with the tractors and hopefully have a bit of a result. But it's a starting point anyway. Well, here we are. One never stops learning in life, that's what I find. And the world of Lamborghini tractors is indeed an interesting one. Here we have a publication on the subject. And having read this from cover to cover, I am now an extremely anorakish, not expert, but at least I have scratched the surface, with Lamborghini tractors. And they go on and on and on and on, which is all very gripping. But what we really want to ascertain is what was happening in 1961 with Ferruccio and his Ferrari. So this is a Lamborghini 1R. It's a little tiddler of a tractor. It's a two-cylinder air-cooled diesel. It's 1500cc and the clutch is just there. So what we're going to do is split the tractor and take the clutch out and see if it matches the Ferrari. Hopefully it does. If not, then we do have another ace up our sleeve. Let's see if we can bust the myth once and for all.
Keep your wheel straight that side, right? Yeah. Great work, mate. Well, sit. Push your wheel forward that side, mate. There you go. It's nice and gentle, mate. Yeah, go forward.
This is too exciting for words. Never knew a clutch could be so. Looks a bit small, this, to me. Okay. just wondering if this tape measure is big enough. 8 inches. Oh, no. That's out of a mini or something like that. That's too small. Too small enough. That is a major blow. Right, okay. Well, it definitely wasn't this tractor he took the clutch out of. That's no Ferrari clutch, that's for sure. Right. We can stick it back together now.
Okay.
Well, there we are. Not great. This is the Lamborghini 1R tractor with the two-cylinder engine, and we've demonstrated that the clutch is not the one that Ferruccio put in his Ferrari. It's too small. It should be a 9-inch clutch plate. They used imperial measurements in those days, and it's 8, so we'll have to see what we can do, what the plan B is. Well, okay, that was a fail. We've ended up with a clutch that was smaller than we anticipated. The clutch that was fitted to the Ferrari originally was a 9-inch coil spring type clutch. That was the technology at the time. In 1965, they changed to a diaphragm type clutch, which I can go into more detail about later. But what's happened is that a lot of classic cars of that era have actually been uprated to diaphragm clutches. But before I get ahead of myself, here we have hopefully another attempt to try and nail this clutch. And this is a Lamborghini 4R tractor. Same era, 1960, 61, 62. And this is the daddy of Lamborghini tractors at the time. These days, this is a baby of a tractor, but in the 1960s, this was a serious, serious bit of kit. And it was actually twice the price of the 2R, the 1R and the 2R, which we looked at earlier. And this one has got a 3-litre, 4-cylinder version of the 2-litre, 1500cc engine that was in the other tractor. So it's actually that engine doubled up. That's what it is. It's modular construction in the 1960s, quite ahead of its time, actually. So many manufacturers use modular engines now in different sizes and different ways. He was doing it in 1960, old Ferruccio Lamborghini. So we've got this tractor split again. The clutch is right in the middle of the tractor. We've got it split down the middle. We're ready to take the clutch off, and let's really hope this is it, because the suspense is killing me. Okay, let's try it. Oh, right, yeah. That's not going to help, is it?
Very careful, a bit more weighted.
Yeah. I'm still wondering if this is a bit low.
It's coming in.
That'll do, won't it?
Yeah.
Ooh, first impressions are that this is a bit big. This again is a coil spring clutch, so it's very, very early technology. But okay, we live in hope, we'll see. This looks rather heavy. It's got a balancing mark on it here, obviously for when it's running at 5,000 revs. There's one more here. There we go. Is that it?
Yeah.
Whee. Ooh. Leon, could you bring the trusty measure, please? I think that's too big, but 10 inch. Oh well, back to the drawing board. There is one in between, so let's hope that's it. Oh, it was never going to be easy, this. 60 years of history doesn't want to give up easily. There we go. Back to the drawing board. Well, we've had a fail with two out of three. We've tried the two-cylinder tractor, the 1R, and we've tried the four-cylinder tractor, both from 1961, that sort of time, which is exactly when Ferruccio would be doing all this. So we're going to put this back together now, and we're going to see if we can find a three-cylinder Lamborghini tractor and hope it's got a 9-inch clutch in it, which will match, hopefully, exactly the Ferrari clutch, at least dimensionally. That's the plan. It was never going to be easy. Best things in life never are, he says. We'll carry on. Back to the drawing board. Well, the good news is we've been tasked with restoring this car as well back to its former glory when Ferruccio was owning and driving it. And this is a massive honour, but it's just so exciting to be able to lift the lid on something that was mythical and turn it into a proper thing that you can touch. And one day I'll be driving this car as Ferruccio did. But that's a long way away. We've got to make various parts which have gone missing over the years and gone their different ways. Got to carefully remake all those bits and also prove this clutch myth once and for all. We've got to find that middle three-cylinder tractor clutch. But in the meantime, this is the end of part one. Thank you for watching this momentous moment in motoring history, and we'll be back with episode two in due course.